Our brains are amazing in that they constantly change and adapt throughout our lives. And this adaptation and rewiring of our brain is known as something as called neuroplasticity. And we can use neuroplasticity to train our minds to handle anxiety differently. For years, scientists believed that after childhood, our brains were pretty much set in stone, that the growth and development of our brains ended with adolescence. But more recently, research has shown that our brains can reorganize themselves and change and alter and be rewired no matter how old we are. So what this means is that if you're struggling with anxiety, your brain has the power to rewire itself, creating new pathways that can help you manage anxiety more effectively. And in today's video, we're going to be talking about how neuroplasticity works, how anxiety rewires your brain in the first place, and most importantly, how you can start changing the way your brain handles anxiety-provoking thoughts and feelings. So to better understand how neuroplasticity works, I want to talk about a well-known research study from 2000 involving London taxi drivers. And these drivers had to memorize a tremendous amount of information, every street, every landmark, every route in the city. It's something they refer to as the knowledge. And it can take years of studying to learn all of this information. And so what researchers did is they took brain scans of these drivers before and after their training. And the scans showed that the hippocampus, the part of the brain that's involved in memory, had physically grown in size as they did the training. And this happened because the taxi drivers' brains rewired themselves to store all of that new information. So the takeaway from this is that our brain changes based on how we use it. It doesn't matter if it's learning new skills like driving or playing an instrument or confronting your fears, your brain is always adapting. And this is important for anyone struggling with anxiety because it can mean that you can train your brain to respond to anxiety differently. So it's important to start by talking about what anxiety actually is. Many people think of anxiety as this sort of enemy that they need to get rid of. But anxiety itself isn't inherently bad. It's actually a survival mechanism. Imagine that you're standing at the edge of a cliff. That rush of anxiety that you feel is your brain telling you, be careful, this could be dangerous. Maybe take a step back. Or let's say you've got a big presentation coming up at work. The anxiety you feel in anticipation of that presentation, that anxiety is meant as a little bit of a push to help prepare you to perform well. Anxiety is like a warning signal. It tells us when something important is happening or when there's a potential threat. The problem is that sometimes our brains send danger signals when there's no real danger. It's kind of like a smoke detector in your home that's gotten way too sensitive, and so it goes off every time you make toast. The alarm is going off even though there isn't actually any danger. And it's similar with anxiety disorders, where a person feels anxious when there's no realistic threat, and that anxiety then begins to interfere with the person's life. And to understand how anxiety spirals out of control, you can think of anxiety kind of like a cycle. Imagine you're walking in a park and you see a large dog. For most people, this might be a neutral or even positive experience. But if you have a fear of dogs, your brain interprets this situation as really dangerous. Suddenly, you feel that rush of anxiety, your heart races, your palms get sweaty, your stomach tightens, all of these anxiety symptoms. And so your immediate response? You turn around and you leave the park. In that moment, your brain is reinforcing the idea that avoiding the dog saved you from danger. It's like your brain said to you, great job, you escaped. Let's do that again next time. This is how avoidance feeds anxiety. The more you avoid what makes you anxious, the more your brain believes that avoidance is the only way to stay safe. And this pattern gets repeated in all kinds of scenarios, whether it's avoiding a social event or skipping a doctor's appointment, or even steering clear of crowded places. Every time you avoid, your brain reinforces those neural pathways that tell you that this situation is dangerous. And over time, your anxiety grows and your world starts to shrink. So imagine I have a fear of public speaking. The first time I'm asked to give a presentation at work, I immediately feel anxious. So I find a way to avoid it. Maybe I tell my boss I'm not feeling well. And so I get out of it and my anxiety goes down and I feel a sense of relief. But the next time I'm asked to do a presentation at work, that anxiety comes back even stronger and I have to find another way again to avoid it. Soon I start avoiding meetings altogether. Then I might start avoiding social gatherings where I might have to speak to people. Eventually, I may avoid answering phone calls. What started out as anxiety around one situation has now expanded to affect all sorts of areas of my life. And this is how avoidance can make your world feel smaller and more constricted, limiting your ability to fully engage with life. But the positive thing is that you can interrupt and reverse this process. By gradually facing the things that make you anxious, you can train your brain and teach your brain that these situations aren't as dangerous as they seem. And this is where neuroplasticity comes into play. Every time you face a fear and you don't avoid it, your brain rewires itself, weakening those anxious pathways and strengthening new, healthier ones. And so how do we do this? What are the steps to rewire your brain against anxiety? Well, the first step is creating what's called an exposure hierarchy. You don't have to jump straight into the deep end of your fear. The idea is to start small. If you have a fear of flying, for example, the idea isn't to book a long international flight as your first step. Instead, you might begin by looking at pictures of planes and then progressing to watching videos of flights on YouTube or visiting the airport or eventually taking a short local flight. This is a gradual process, and we call it an exposure hierarchy, and it's really, really effective for reducing anxiety. By taking small, manageable exposure steps, you're giving your brain a chance to slowly adjust and learn that these situations aren't dangerous or aren't as dangerous as they seem. And every successful exposure weakens the anxious neural pathways, and over time, you'll find that what once seemed impossible feels a lot more manageable. The next step is to change your internal rules. And what I mean by this is that many of us have internal rules that manage or dictate how we handle anxiety. So for example, you might think, I'll go to that concert, but only if I don't feel anxious. The problem with this mindset is that you're letting your anxiety dictate what you're doing. Instead, what you want to do is to accept that it's okay to feel anxious and that you can still go into the feared situation anyway. So imagine if I'm afraid of public speaking. I might make a rule that I'll only give a presentation if I'm feeling calm. But the reality is, anxiety often shows up when we're doing something important. So I'm never going to feel calm enough to give a presentation. So instead of waiting for the anxiety to disappear, what I need to do is to practice being courageous by giving the presentation even if I'm anxious. And by doing so, I'm teaching my brain that it's okay to feel anxious and that I can still function and still perform in that situation. And the third step is to do the gradual exposure and work your way up the exposure hierarchy. This is often the most difficult step, but it's also the most important. When you face your fear, your anxiety will likely increase at first because your brain is used to avoiding the feared situation. And so it will push you to want to escape when you're doing your exposures. So the key is to resist that urge to escape and to stay in the situation and to watch what happens to the anxiety. It may go up, But as you stay in the situation, it eventually starts to come down as you give your brain time to recognize that the fear is unfounded. So let's say I'm afraid of driving on the highways. The first time I try it, my heart races and my hands get sweaty. But if I stick with it, maybe by driving on the highway for 20 or 30 minutes, my brain starts to learn that I'm safe. And over time, my anxiety starts to decrease, and the next time, it won't feel as overwhelming. And this gradual exposure is rewiring my brain and breaking that anxiety cycle. So rewiring your brain to reduce anxiety is a process. It takes time, it takes effort, and it takes planning, but it works. By facing your fears, by changing the rules that you've set for yourself, and by sticking with that discomfort and anxiety when you do exposure, you're giving your brain a chance to learn new, healthier, less fearful ways of responding to anxiety. And if you're interested in learning more about the differences between therapeutic exposure and everyday exposures, I'd encourage you to check out this video. So that's all for today's video. As always, thank you for making it all the way to the end of this video, and I will see you in the next one.